Let us worship God and seek God's face together. We assemble once again this morning under the throne of heaven to lift up our praise to the Lord. And we'll begin by singing in his praise from Psalm 121. Psalm 121, we'll sing the whole psalm to the tune French, which, if you have a red psalter with the tunes at the top, is found on page 64. Psalm 121, this sets before us the Lord as our keeper. The word is actually used six times, translated sometimes as keep or keeper, other times as preserve. But the theme is to set before us the fact that the Lord is the one who is upholding and sustaining us as his people, and we worship him as such. So let's sing to him Psalm 121. Stand together for prayer. Our gracious and eternal God, we come into your presence acknowledging that indeed you are the keeper of Israel. You know the going out and the coming in of your people, and always we have underneath the everlasting arms. We are thankful, O Lord, for that preserving grace which sustains us moment by moment in your divine grace. And we would come this day and bow down our hearts before you to extol and magnify your great name. For you, O Lord, are the one whom the angels in heaven even now extol with those words, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. And so we too would join our voices with that heavenly throng and worship you in the beauty of your holiness. We ask, O Lord, that you would be pleased to send forth your Spirit among us, that you would draw out our hearts in praise and adoration, that you would give us fit spiritual frames that would be enabled to worship you in spirit and in truth, to bring you glory. We come, O Lord, thankful especially for your Son and our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, our rock and our Redeemer. We are thankful that he has been exalted to your right hand, the right hand of the Majesty on high, where he rules and reigns as the King of Kings and as the Lord of Lords. We confess that he is Messiah the Prince, and that he is the one who, with his iron rod, rules over the nations, bringing destruction to those who rebel against him, and bringing his blessing to those who submit to him. We pray, O Lord, that he would come forth as our King and subdue us unto himself, and that he would be the one ruling and reigning over us. Grant that we would be servants of yours, that we would be those devoted in all that we do with our time and priorities and our decisions, that we would be seeking first your kingdom and righteousness, that our bodies would be members of righteousness, that they would be sacrifices that are offered as acceptable in your sight, that we would employ the gifts and graces that you give to us for the advance of your kingdom. O Lord, come in and among us this day and bless us with a sense of your presence. Grant that in the singing of your praise that you would come and inhabit them, that as we lift up your inspired songs in adoration, that you, O Lord, would also lift up, stir up our affections and mold them into the pattern of your word. Help us to set our minds on things above. Grant that your word would have free course and be glorified as it is read and preached, that Christ, as our great prophet, would be standing in our midst, bringing a word from heaven to nourish and strengthen our souls. Help us to mingle our hearing with faith to the profit of our spiritual benefit. We come, O Lord, asking that you would have mercy upon us. Indeed, we are sinners. We have and continue to transgress all of your commandments. And yet, if we break one of the least of them, we're guilty of the whole. We confess, O Lord, that we have sinned against you knowingly, that we have sinned with knowledge, that we, O Lord, have left much undone that you have required of us. And yet you have told us that if we sin, that we have an advocate with you, the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, who is the propitiation of our sins. And we bless your holy name for him, for the Savior of sinners, who took the cup from your hand and drank that cup of wrath, to its very bottom, satisfying your wrath, canceling guilt, coming and becoming the curse of the law in the place of your people. We thank you for such a wondrous gospel, a gospel of free grace. And we ask, O Lord, that for the sake of the Lord Jesus Christ, you would forgive and cleanse us from our many sins. Remember us, O Lord, with pity and tenderness and all of our brokenness and neediness. Grant that you would draw nigh out of your sufficiency to provide for our acute want and need. We ask, O Lord, that you would bless especially the advance of your kingdom. We pray for our brethren in the south of Sudan and those in the Nuba Mountains. We thank you for the testimony which is being borne, for your word which is being upheld and spread. O Lord, brace and bolster them amidst all of the war with Islam and the struggle that lies at their very doorstep. Give them an increase of faith, that they would have their hearts and minds set on things above as well, that you would preserve and keep them, that you would overthrow all of your and their enemies, that you would push back the tide, and that you would cause, O Lord, the gospel to advance and the influences of false religion to recede, that we would see the kingdom of Christ built upon the ruins of the kingdom of Satan, his kingdom of grace advanced in the world. Bless, we ask, our own circumstances as a congregation. We pray for those who have been bereaved in recent times, and pray that you would impart your sympathy and consolation to buoy up and strengthen them in these seasons. We ask that they would be assured that when others have moved on and forgotten, that you never forget, that you are a God who is with your people, who never will leave or forsake them. We ask, O Lord, that you would look upon those physically afflicted who have been laid low with various forms of sickness. These are your precious jewels, whom you have in your wisdom afflicted, and which you are using to bring yourself glory in heaven as well as in earth. We ask that you would sanctify these sorrows to your people, and that if you would be pleased, that you would visit them with mercy and raising up and strengthening them to serve you with increased vigor in the days ahead. We ask, O Lord, for your blessing upon our covenant children. We desire to see a godly seed raised for your glory. And we thank you, O Lord, for all the means given, for the preaching of your word, for family worship and discipline and Christian education and catechetical instruction. But we're also mindful, O Lord, that we cannot give them what they need most, that is a new heart. And so we look to you and to your sovereign and irresistible spirit, praying that you would come forth and that you would take out hearts of stone and give them hearts of flesh, that you would remove the veil from their eyes and give them faith to see and embrace Christ as he is offered in the gospel. We ask as well, O Lord, that you would strengthen your redeemed people in our walk before you, that we would increase in holiness, that our appetite for sin and the things of this world would wane, and that we would see an increased delight in you chiefly above all else, that you would be our joy and our cause of rejoicing, that your word would dwell in us richly, that we might not sin against you. We ask, O Lord, that you would come to us to feed and strengthen us this day. If even the dogs are able to eat the crumbs from the master's table, how much more will you not give your children the true bread of Christ and of your word to fortify and to sanctify us? And so, Lord, we ask that you would do this very thing, that you would come and grant to us your word and spirit together, working that perfect will within our souls, and that incorruptible seed of the gospel would come with power to awaken sinners from their sleep of death and to bring them into newness of life through the Lord Jesus Christ. O Lord, bless our nation. Grant that in all of our wickedness that you would be pleased to turn us to a season of brokenness and of repentance before you. We pray for the reformation and reviving of the cause of Zion and of your church, that you, O Lord, would make Zion a praise of all and all the earth, and give us a prayerful spirit, that spirit of grace and supplications, which would wrestle with you for these blessings and give you no rest until you grant these importunate cries. O Lord, raise us up and grant that we would return to you, the Lord, that you would heal our backslidings, and that you would freely forgive, and that you would restore life and strength to your decrepit people. We ask that you would be with us in our service. O Lord, come and make known your power, show the strength of your right arm in all that we are about, and grant that you would be pleased to glorify and magnify your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Let's continue to worship the Lord by lifting up our hearts and voices to him and singing from Psalm 60. We have sung through the book of Psalms many times, and in our second and third singing, we're continuing to do that, so we're making our way back through the Psalms again, and we come this morning to the second half of Psalm 60, where we left off last, verses 6 to 12. The tune is Paisley, which is tune number 97. Here we see the Lord in the latter part of this psalm, the Lord subduing peoples to himself, so that as we were called upon to cry out in verse 5 earlier, that he would deliver us, so we are assured in verses 11 and 12, help us from trouble, for the help is vain which man supplies. Through God we'll do great acts, he shall tread down our enemies. Let's sing to God's praise. Psalm 60, verses 6 to 12.
Hear it, I will.
Let us worship God in the reading of his word. Our first reading, our Old Testament reading, is found in the prophet Isaiah. We'll be reading from Isaiah chapter 61. So if you'll take your copy of God's word and turn with me to Isaiah chapter 61. Let us give careful attention to the reading of God's inspired word. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord hath anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. He hath sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to them that are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all that mourn, to appoint unto them that mourn in Zion, to give unto them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that they might be called trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he might be glorified. And they shall build the old wastes, they shall raise up the former desolations, and they shall repair the waste cities, the desolations of many generations. And strangers shall stand and feed your flocks, and the sons of the alien shall be your plowmen and your vine dressers. But ye shall be named the priests of the Lord. Men shall call you the ministers of our God. Ye shall eat the riches of the Gentiles, and in their glory shall ye boast yourselves. For your shame ye shall have double, and for confusion they shall rejoice in their portion. Therefore in their land they shall possess the double, everlasting joy shall be unto them. For I, the Lord, love judgment. I hate robbery for burnt offering. And I will direct their work in truth, and I will make an everlasting covenant with them. And their seed shall be known among the Gentiles, and their offspring among the people. All that see them shall acknowledge them, that they are the seed which the Lord hath blessed. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My soul shall be joyful in my God. For he hath clothed me with the garments of salvation. He hath covered me with the robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decketh himself with ornaments, and as a bride adorneth herself with her jewels. For as the earth bringeth forth her bud, and as the garden causeth the things that are sown in it to spring forth, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to spring forth before all nations. Amen. May the Lord bless the reading of this portion of his holy word. Let's continue to worship the Lord by singing together from Psalm 61. We'll sing the whole psalm. The tune is Old 44th, which is tune number 152. So we'll sing together all of Psalm 61. Notice the opening of the psalm directs our gaze to the Lord himself. When our hearts are overwhelmed within us, the waters are crashing in over us, what do? We fix our eyes upon the rock that is higher than us, namely the Lord Jesus Christ himself. So let's sing to the Lord Psalm 61.
Oh,
Turn our attention again to the reading of God's Word, and our New Testament reading is found in the book of Romans, Paul's epistle to the church at Rome. We'll read together chapter 6, Romans chapter 6. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? Know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death? Therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection, knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. For he that is dead is freed from sin. Now if we be dead with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him, knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, dieth no more, death hath no more dominion over him. For in that he died unto sin once, but in that he liveth unto God. Likewise, reckon ye also yourselves to be dead, indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that ye should obey it in the lusts thereof, neither yield ye your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for ye are not under the law, but under grace. What then? Shall we sin because we are not under the law, but under grace? God forbid. Know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey, his servants ye are to whom ye obey, whether of sin unto death or of obedience unto righteousness? But God be thanked that ye were the servants of sin, but ye have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered you. Being then made free from sin, ye became the servants of righteousness. I speak after the manner of men, because of the infirmity of your flesh. For as ye have yielded your members servants to uncleanness, and to iniquity unto iniquity, even so now yield your members servants to righteousness unto holiness. For when ye were the servants of sin, ye were free from righteousness. What fruit had ye then in those things whereof ye are now ashamed? For the end of those things is death. But now being made free from sin and become servants to God, ye have your fruit unto holiness and the end, everlasting life. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please take your Bibles and turn with me this morning to the Gospel of John, chapter 8. We are engaged in an exposition of this fourth Gospel, and in this series of sermons, we come this morning to John 8, and our text is verses 33 to 36. The Gospel of John, chapter 8, we'll be considering together with the Lord's help, verses 33 to 36. They answered him, "We be Abraham's seed, and were never in bondage to any man. How sayest thou, ye shall be made free?" Jesus answered them, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, whosoever committeth sin is the servant of sin. And the servant abideth not in the house forever, but the Son abideth ever. If the Son, therefore, shall make you free, ye shall be free indeed." Every country has characteristics that define its national identity. Suppose I could mention various European countries like Switzerland or Germany or the French or the Irish, and there would be one or two characteristics that would probably come to your mind, part of the national identity of those people. Well, in the United States, our national identity, without a doubt, is dominated by the concept of liberty, of freedom. From the very beginning, the inception of our country and the war against England, in the colonial era, we had speeches like that of Patrick Henry, who cried out, "Give me liberty or give me death." And to the present day, that theme continues. We consider ourselves the land of the free. And you look at even some of our most famous monuments. We have the Statue of Liberty in the New York Harbor, which has inscribed on it, "Yearning to breathe liberty." We have the Liberty Bell in Philly, and many other things like that. You think of how this concept is enshrined in our Constitution, for example, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, or how it's codified in the Bill of Rights, the freedom of religion, of free association, freedom of speech, freedom of press, freedom from search and seizure, and so on. Even our coins have stamped in bold upon them the word liberty. Our national identity is dominated by the concept of liberty or of freedom. But it leaves us, I think, with a haunting question. What does it mean to be free? All this talk, all the bravado, but what does it mean to be free? How exactly would you define liberty? This is a good question, I think, for us to ponder. And perhaps there would be a multitude of answers. If we asked the common person on the street, many of them would say something like, well, it's the unrestrained ability to do what I want. You know, the power to choose, if it were. And there may be other variations on that theme. Well, here we are in the Gospel of John, chapter 8. And in this text, Jesus defines for us true liberty. Jesus defines true liberty. And in doing so, he shatters the world's idea, both then and now. We can hear the shards crunching under our feet. So we'll look at two things this morning as we consider this portion of God's word. First of all, slavery of sin. So first of all, slavery of sin, focusing especially on verses 33, 34, and 35. Let's remember our context from last Lord's Day, where we were considering the previous text. There are those who have come to Jesus, who have heard his preaching, and who have said, we believe what you're saying. And Jesus' response, his counsel to them is, you must continue in my word. You must continue in my teaching. So it's not good enough to begin well, but you need to be sustained, persevering in the truth that you have received from me. And he says, and that truth will make you free. That truth that I give you will make you free. And so then we come to this, the passage that we're considering, and there's an objection raised by the Pharisees. The Pharisees hear Jesus say, the truth shall make you free, and they object, and they say, do you know who you are talking to? You know, do you know who it is that you're addressing? They're stupefied, if you will. How is it that you're talking to us about freedom? What did they say in verse 33? They answered him, we be Abraham's seed, and were never in bondage to any man. How sayest thou, ye shall be made free? Their pride is bristling. We are Abraham's seed. We are the greatest people in all of the earth, the most privileged, those who sit, as it were, at the top of the food chain. We have never been in bondage. Well, you hear the words fall from their lips, And we're forced to shake our heads, aren't we? Because at least on the surface, there's some irony here, if not delusion. You have never been in bondage, really. Have you forgotten the groans that you uttered under the tyrannical boot of Pharaoh in Egypt? Have you forgotten the humiliation of the Babylonian exile, or those who replaced them subsequently, the Medes and the Persians and then the Greeks? And what about now? What about at the present time, where Rome has come in and occupied this portion of the world? Surely these people know what it means to be restricted, never in bondage. They're at this very moment subjugated to a foreign power, taxed by them, and so on. But perhaps what they mean is, we are free at heart. Yes, 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 we have had Egypt, and we've had Babylon, and we've had Rome, and so on and so forth. We've been outwardly occupied, but we are unbroken. You know, we have not given up. We have not submitted. We are free before the Lord. And it's very interesting, because undoubtedly that's what they mean. And here is exactly where Jesus puts his finger. If they're saying we are free inside, that we are free in our hearts, Jesus confronts that very place. And he says, no, it is in your heart that you are in the greatest bondage. Inside your soul, you are in the greatest bondage. You are chained by sin. Jesus answered them, verily, verily, I say unto you, whosoever committeth sin is the servant or slave of sin. Whoever commits sin is the slave of sin. The greatest bondage is the one you cannot see. It's the greatest bondage, the enemy, the tyrant that is within each and every one of the souls of the natural man. Here the Lord Jesus Christ is saying, you think you're free, when in fact you are in servitude. Now this is true, of course, not only of the Pharisees. It is true of all of those outside of the Lord Jesus Christ. But it is a truth that the natural man cannot abide, cannot tolerate. To tell someone you're a slave is to provoke them, is to inflame them. They cannot tolerate it. But, my friends, it is absolutely true. It is absolutely true what the Lord Jesus Christ is saying. And it is the truth, indeed, that is needed for liberty. Jesus says, verily, verily. This is what one of the ways, or truly, truly, one of the ways that he marks out by emphasis. What I'm about to say is extremely significant. Children, it's like when your dad, your daddy, or mama say, listen to me, look at me, listen to me, right? They want concentrated attention. This is what Jesus is doing. He's saying, this is important. Those who are in sin are slaves of sin, and this is the worst kind of bondage, far worse than physical slavery. If you are physically enslaved, then you are restricted in your movements. You have to do what other people are telling you. You may have to wear chains and things like that. Your arms are bound and so on. And that's, you know, a difficult circumstance to be in, obviously. But Jesus is saying this is far, far, far worse. Your heart, your will, your affections have been captivated. To the degree that all that the natural man can do is sin. He's a slave. He obeys sin. He heeds it. When tempted, he gives way to it. He orders his or her life according to it. There is true captivity here. They're not able, for example, to please God or to do what glorifies him or to do that which he deems good. And so there are those who think that they're free. They say, I am free because I am doing whatever I like. But then the question comes, what is it that you like? And even a better question, what is it that you are able or capable of liking? I am free because I can do whatever I like. But my friends, if you're outside of the Lord Jesus Christ, what you like is sinful, and all that you can do is sinful. There is none that are good. Paul says, no, not one. We sin because we are sinners. We don't become sinners because we sin. It's because there's this sinful nature that out of the foment of that depraved condition, all of our sins arise. It's not our environment. It's not our training. It's not the example of others. It's within us. Our nature is one that is sinful and inclined to sin. Men will do what is wrong. And they'll do what is wrong even when they know that what they're doing hurts. Even when they know something of the consequences that will come from this. And yet they do it. They go headlong through with it. Why? Jesus says, because they are enslaved. There is a lack of power in resisting sin. There's a native weakness to resisting sin. Men are unable to master themselves. They are rather mastered by their habits of self-indulgence and so on. So Jesus goes on in verse 35 and says, and the servant abideth not in the house forever, but the son abideth ever. Now this is probably a parenthetical, a difficult verse in some ways to understand, but he's, I believe, pointing us back to their words in verse 33, the reference to them being the seed of Abraham. And he's reminding them, guess what? Abraham had many children. He had more than just Isaac. In other words, he is bringing to the fore of their mind a story that would have been very familiar, very popular among them, the account of Hagar and Ishmael. He says, Abraham had a house. And he had the son of promise there. But there was also this bondwoman, the slave, Hagar, and her son. And they were cast out. They were driven out of the house, whereas the son of promise remained in the house. He's saying, look, those who are slaves, they are there by permission. They are not natural residents, as it were. They don't have all of the rights that a son has. They're not permanent. Slaves don't have the privileges of the house like a son does. Paul uses this same example in that passage in Galatians 4. We'll just read, rather than that whole section, just the last two verses. Nevertheless, what saith the Scripture, cast out the bondwoman and her son, for the son of the bondwoman shall not be heir with the son of the free woman. So then, brethren, we are not children of the bondwoman, but of the free. What he's saying is, Pharisees, you claim to be the seed of Abraham. You are, in fact, the seed of the bondwoman. You're slaves in this house. And here is the son. Here is the son that is standing before them. And they are rejecting self-consciously and vehemently the Savior while presuming on their so-called status. Jesus is saying, you can be cast out. You reject me. You reject the Son. You can be cast out. If you receive the Son, as we go on to see, you will have the privileges of being adopted sons and daughters. And in having all of the privileges of adoption, you have the status and all of the benefits or perks that come with those that live in his household. You will be free to please the Father. You will be free to serve the Lord Jesus Christ, to be numbered among the people of God. Here is the Son, and they are, in fact, slaves. And earlier on in our study, a long time ago now, John chapter 1, verse 12, it says, Jesus says, but as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. Well, this has all sorts of, I think, far-reaching ramifications for us, this biblical truth regarding the slavery of sin. the slavery of sin. It first of all, I think, collides with something in our national identity. There is, I think, nothing more that defines our country than so-called liberty. And yet, Jesus is making clear in this passage that true freedom is only found in and under the Lord Jesus Christ. It is defined by Christ. It is received by Christ. It is employed for the glory of Christ. And the worst kind of bondage, as I said earlier, is the kind that people can't see. Inability to please the Lord, to bow down before Him, to serve Him, to bring Him glory. Well, this is the state that we are in. You dispose of Christ. This is true individually. This is true nationally. You dispose of Christ. You, in those moments, lose all liberty. It's gone. It vaporizes. There is no true liberty without the Lord Jesus Christ and His reign as King and His redemption as Savior. It is necessary for us to heed these words, because if we reject the truth, then we are abandoning freedom. Freedom to serve the Lord and to please Him. But it's also true on a personal level. This paints a rather grim picture, doesn't it? I mean, we can pull up into our minds some of the most base forms of slavery in the modern world, right? Slavery is alive and well, especially in countries where Islam is ruling the roost, but elsewhere as well. And there are very graphic, very horrific pictures, that ideas that come to our mind. And this is what slavery looks like. And the Lord is saying, my friends, outside of the Lord Jesus Christ, that's you. You're the one bound, hand and foot. Worse, you're the one chained in your heart and will and affections and mind under the dominion, the tyranny and undominable power of sin. Well, that's pretty grim, but it shows us, I think, it shows us our true state of desperation outside of the Lord Jesus Christ. All attempts to please Him, praying, reading your Bible, showing up at church from time to time, even habitually, these things are nothing. They're unable to sever the cords of sin in and of themselves. And if you're outside of the Lord Jesus this morning, you ought to feel, if you are taking on all that this text brings to us, you ought to feel the chains, as it were, cutting into your wrists. Here we see the nature of our situation. And it's not only bondage now, but those who die in sin, under the dominion of sin, controlled by sin, what happens? We have hell. There's the prison of eternal torment that awaits. There's a sense in which we could modify Patrick Henry's well-known phrase from that speech in Virginia. And we could say, give me true liberty, or I will be given eternal death. Right? Give me true liberty from Christ in the gospel by His grace, or all I'll have, like it or not, is death. So there's the slavery of sin. Secondly, we are set free in Christ. So secondly, set free in Christ. In verse 36, if the Son, therefore, shall make you free, ye shall be free indeed. And that first word is, I think, crucial for us. If and only if the Son makes you free, are you free indeed, or truly free, knowing true liberty. Our Westminster Confession has a wonderful section on this in chapter 20. And if you have time this afternoon or this evening, you pull that down off your shelf and read paragraph 1, where you have, in a very condensed, very tight space, a description of Christian liberty, of the liberty that we have in the Lord Jesus Christ. A great summary, I think, of the biblical doctrine. This is liberty purchased at the high cost of the Lord Jesus Christ and his blood himself. And so Jesus is saying, if I set you free, if the Son makes you free, you will be free indeed. What does that entail? Well, it entails freedom from guilt. Freedom from guilt. Now, as I've often made clear, we need to distinguish between guilt objectively and guilt subjectively. So I'm not saying making you free from feeling guilty. I'm talking about the actual objective declaration of guilt. Here is God's holy law, and here are you. And when God's law is held up on one side and you're held up on the other, and you're judged according to that law, the verdict, the sentence that comes forth is guilty. You're guilty as charged by God's law. You have broken the law of God. And that breach of the law of God comes with a just and equitable punishment or payment for our transgressions. We are justly condemned because of our guilt. And we justly receive the sentence of the wrath of God himself. As we saw there in Romans 6, the wages of sin is death. And so when called before the divine tribunal on the last day at the judgment seat, this would be our condition. Jesus is saying, I have freed my people from guilt. I have set them free. Christ has redeemed his people. In other words, Jesus came and purchased. He bought slaves. He bought a people who were slaves under the dominion of Satan in the kingdom of darkness, bound by sin. He purchased them with his own blood and redeemed them by the strength of his own right arm. They're purchased with the blood of Christ in payment for sin, so that our debt is completely canceled before him. In 1 Peter chapter 1, Peter speaks of this in verses 18 and 19. For as much as ye know that ye were not redeemed with corruptible things as silver and gold from your vain conversation received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. So we're free from guilt. We're also free from the dominion of sin, the domination, the control of sin. The Lord Jesus Christ has freed us by his own power. And this is one of the things that's emphasized over and over in that passage we read from Romans chapter 6, where he's saying, you've died to sin. You're no longer under the dominion of sin. In verse 14, for sin shall not have dominion over you. At one time, you lived in a kingdom, and there was a tyrant who reigned over it, and you were bound and controlled and restricted and subjugated in that world of sin. But for the Christian, Christ has come and snatched his people out from under that dominion, brought them into the kingdom of his own beloved Son, into the kingdom of life and liberty in the Lord Jesus Christ, delivering us from that. Now we have the presence of sin that remains with us. That's true. That is removed at death. We are perfected in holiness. Our souls are perfected in holiness at death. The presence of sin is still here, but no longer the power that sin had in its dominion over us. In other words, we are sons and daughters, not slaves. So the Christian is not a slave to sin to obey all of the lusts that are there, but rather the Christian is a son of the living God and able, a daughter of the living God, able rather to disobey and defy sin, no longer our master, and rather enabled to obey and submit to the Lord Jesus Christ. I mean, if we had a British agent from the British government come here and say, listen, you know, you were a colony of England, and I'm here to inform you, you need to pay homage to the king, you need to submit to British rule and law, and so on and so forth, we would laugh them out of the room. We'd run them out of town on a rail. Why? We're not under the Queen. We're not under the government of Britain any longer. We've been free for 200 years from that. But it's the same. The Lord is saying, you've been set free from this dominion of sin. We are able now not to sin. Previously, those who are unconverted are not able not to sin. The Christian is able not to sin by God's grace through the work of the Holy Spirit. We are free to obey Him, not with slavish fear, but with childlike faith. We're also free from the curse of the law, right? This curse demands, the law demands a penalty. This holy law reflects a holy God, right? The law is a transcript of God's holiness. It is a revelation of the character of God Himself, of His own holiness. And there is a curse then that comes with the law that condemns us. We're told that the Lord Jesus Christ came, stood as a substitute in the place of His people, and became the curse for us on behalf of His people, satisfying the demands of the curse of the law. And if that's not enough, Christ has taken up the law and obeyed it with flawless, sinless perfection. There we see the righteousness of the Lord Jesus Christ. He's obeyed the law on behalf of His people in order that His righteousness might be credited to the account of His people. There's another way in which we're free from the law. There was, under the Old Testament, the ceremonial law, right? So prior to the coming of the Messiah, the Lord came to His people under age, and He, by divine appointment and prescription, gave them in their worship and in their life and national identity a picture book. Very colorful, very fragrant, very graphic picture book. All of the temple and its ceremonies, the sacrifices and the priests with their garments and all of the things that were associated with that, the other forms of ceremonial law, the purity and cleanness and uncleanness laws, all of this governing the people. And it was a tool to point forward as shadows to the substance, the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, the one being typified. It was revealing to them something of who Jesus would be and what Jesus would accomplish. Now, when Christ comes, the ceremonial things are laid aside. They're no longer needed. He has arrived. The fullness of the reality of all that Christ is and has accomplished has been fulfilled. And so the ceremonial, distinctively ceremonial elements of the law are set aside. We are free from those. So we read through the New Testament, both in terms of New Testament worship. We don't bring truckloads of the Old Testament typology and import it into New Testament worship. It's Judaizing. But rather we follow the simplicity of worship that has been appointed in the New Testament. We see the same with regards to our lives. All of the laws controlling visible separation and purity and cleanness and so on, these have been lifted from off of us. And so we're able to take the good gifts that God's given in food and to eat those to His glory. They're sanctified by word and prayer and so on. So this is part of the liberty that Christ has purchased for us. But chiefly, as a result of the removal of the curse of the law, there's access to God Himself. We are given access to Him. We are no longer shut out where a steel door has been bolted with big neon signs forbidding us from entry, but rather the door has been blown off its hinges, and we are given full and free access into the presence of God, into the Holy of Holies themselves, into the throne room of heaven, where our high priest mediates and intercedes for us. These are privileges. This is liberty that is given to us. None of us have the freedom to show up in Washington and walk into the White House and go into the president's bedroom and sit down and talk to him. Right? You'll be carried out in a body bag. But the Christian has liberty of access into the presence of the eternal God Himself, the Lord of glory, to behold Him, to lift up our whispers and cries to Him, to receive audience by Him. And the Lord stoops to us to shower from his own hand every conceivable spiritual blessing that is to be found in Christ. He takes us to himself. This is a freedom that God has given to us. We're free also from the doctrines and commandments of men, both in worship and in our life. God has given to us his word, and his word, his truth, as we saw in the previous passage, sets us free. And so all of the truckloads of innovation and depraved ingenuity that men concoct to say this is what's needed and this is what's needed in order to worship God, those things are removed. Right? Those doctrines and commandments are taken away. We're free to worship the Lord as he's appointed for us in his word. The same thing with regards to our life. Right? God has given to us a word from heaven and a light to our path that directs and guides us. How is it that we live before him in a way that will glorify and please him? This book is sufficient. And we don't need, as it were, the tradition of the elders that the Pharisees had concocted or their modern equivalents. There's a liberty that God has given. We're free even from things like the evil of afflictions. Now, we're not free from afflictions. There is no possibility of being a Christian devoid of suffering. Now, it comes in a multitude of shapes and sizes, but every Christian will undergo various forms of trial and affliction, necessarily. Through many difficulties, we'll enter the kingdom of heaven. But the Lord removes the evil of the afflictions. Very different. For the unconverted person, they have all sorts of hardships, trials, difficulties, disappointments that fall upon them. But it's not for their good. It's for their further judgment, as it were, and many other things. Whereas for the Christian, the Lord takes the evil out of it so that the worst things in the Christian life, the most painful, the most burdensome, the most difficult things in the Christian life, those forms of affliction that God tailor fits for us, he says, even that, the worst that you experience, I am pleased to transform into good. I am pleased to take out of all of that glory for myself. I am pleased to bring beauty out of ashes. I'll take what the world says is the worst, the offscouring, and I will gather these things together for my praise. Right? The Lord is, Christ has purchased this liberty for us, the liberty from the evil of afflictions. And what goes with that, of course, further on, more terminal, the sting of death. The sting of death. Where is the sting of death? Paul says. Where is it? Christ has won the victory. Christ has liberated us from that. What about the grave? You know, a person is put into a coffin, lowered into the earth, and all of that weight of dirt is put on top of them. It's sealed shut. And that appears to be bondage. Here you are confined to a box 6 feet under the earth. You are stuck, seemingly for many, forever. The Lord says, not so. Christ sets free his people, and the grave itself cannot contain them. There is victory, there is liberty even over the grave, so that our bodies, still in union with Christ, rest in their graves until the resurrection, when Christ will raise them by the strength of his own power, redeemed and glorified, in order that we might serve and worship him for all of eternity. This is the freedom. Christ says, I will set you free, and you will be free indeed. This is true liberty. This is true freedom. Isn't it interesting, as we think about these biblical truths that are found in this passage, very interesting to contrast this with what the world says, and I fear some of you say, if not out loud to yourselves. And that is, well, to be a Christian means that I have to forego freedoms that I want. To be a Christian means that I'm going to have to submit to restrictions that I would rather not submit to. That I am going to be fettered from doing things that I would like to engage in. Right, this is a common conception, what it means to be a Christian. There are those who say, well, you know, to come to Christ, to receive Christ, to take Christ as Savior and Lord, to close with Him in the gospel, there's a price tag. There's a lot of things that are going to have to change in me and about me. My friends, isn't it interesting? It's the exact opposite is the case, isn't it? Rather than thinking that to become a Christian involves restriction, Jesus is saying to become a Christian is to know for the first time ever true liberty. Now you're only able to do what your own self-centered, self-indulgent, self-satisfying self wants to do. Now you gratify your lusts. Now you drink yourself, you drink in all of the worldly pleasures and so on, and you can't do otherwise. You're a slave. The Lord Jesus is saying, I can set you free. And it is indeed a new world, but not a new world of seeming restriction, so much as a new world of genuine liberty. God is the one who changes us from within so that what we like, our appetites, our tastes, our desires, our priorities, our pursuits, end up being transformed into what please Him. And we have the ability, by God's grace, to pursue what pleases Him. In Romans 8, verse 21, because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. We are brought to love the Bible. We are brought to love other people more than ourselves. We are free from ourselves and free from our sinful pursuits. And we find joy and delight in what is truly joyful and delightful. We see beauty that previously we were blind to. Our eyes are opened. We thought that blindness was the best because that's all we knew. And we lived in the dark hole of ourselves. The Lord brings His people into faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, into the light, and all of a sudden, the whole world opens up. The lights turn on, and we're able to behold chiefly the beauty of the Lord Himself. Well, Jesus tells us, as we saw in Isaiah 61, He came to proclaim liberty to captives. Jesus came for the purpose of proclaiming liberty to captives. That, my friends, is the preaching of the gospel. Christ comes with the gospel proclaiming liberty to captives. And Christ is the one who is able to say, I have won the war. I have conquered, defeated, decimated Satan and sin and hell and death. They are all destroyed by the Lord Jesus Christ. And now He comes proclaiming that liberty in his glorious gospel. My friends, do not allow yourself to be hardened under unbelief. Don't be hardened under unbelief, those of you who are outside of Christ. Don't be giving way to that inclination to embrace slavery, the bondage of darkness. When the Lord Jesus Christ is coming and saying in the gospel, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. When Christ is coming and saying, repent, turn from sin to a merciful God. When the Lord's coming and saying, see yourself as you truly are. Look at the desperate condition of your native depravity and bondage, and look at Me, who am able to set you free indeed. Christian, it also reinforces some things, I think, in our life as well. It is all too easy to slip into a concentration camp mentality. This is part of what Paul is addressing in Romans 6. He's saying, this is what is. This is what you should be thinking in terms of reality about what is. You know, don't slip, as it were, into a concentration camp mentality. I mean, in World War II, when the U.S. defeated Japan, there were POWs, American POWs, in Japan. Well, as soon as the war's won, doesn't mean all of a sudden that they all come pouring out of the concentration camp. News had to come. It had to be proclaimed to them. And then they had to leave the camps in order to go home, to go back to freedom, if you want to say, or their so-called free country. We are not Christians slaves to sin any longer. The Son has set us free. We're able to look into the face of temptation and say, you're not my master anymore. I don't have to obey your lusts. I can resist you. By the ministry of the Holy Spirit, bolstered by the grace of God alone, we can say no to temptation. And the Lord is able to deliver us from it. And it is, there's an account, I don't have it written out here, of Luther, you know, in typical Luther style, in his combat with temptation and sin. There's an account of him, you know, speaking, as it were, metaphorically out loud to sin, saying, I'm not your slave. You know, I've been freed from your dominion. You know, I belong to the Lord Jesus Christ, and now I am free to serve him. This is true. The Lord enables you to want to please him, and then he gives you the grace and freedom to please him, both the desire and the ability to do what is well-pleasing in his sight. How we think about freedom must be shaped by Christ himself. We do not take our cue from the Constitution or what's written on the Statue of Liberty. We take our cue from the truth, which alone is able to set us free. Here is where we begin to understand true liberty, and it is shaped by Christ himself. My friends, it is delusional for a nation, just as it is for individuals, to continue to cling to spiritual slavery and to cry out in vain, "We are free, we are free." The Lord Jesus Christ says to the contrary, "If the Son, therefore, shall make you free, ye shall be free indeed." Let's stand for prayer. Almighty and ever-blessed God in heaven, we come thankful for the declaration, the proclamation that the Lord Jesus Christ brings to our ears and into our hearts, that he has come to proclaim liberty to the captives. How thankful we are, O Lord, that the Son indeed is able to make us truly free, free indeed. Give us, as your people, a renewed sense of the wonder of what it means to be free. A renewed sense of what it means to walk out of the shackles of slavery into the liberty of your Son. O Lord, help us then to live in that liberty to your glory, to please and obey and serve and devote ourselves to all that brings you glory. We pray, O Lord, for the unconverted, that you would be pleased to cause your gospel to demonstrate its power in setting those presently in bondage free. We ask, O Lord, that you would cause your word to accomplish all the purposes for which you have sent it, that your word would not return unto you void. We pray, O Lord, that you would cause us to have our eyes fixed upon Christ, that we would delight in him, cling to him, and prize him. We ask in Jesus' name, amen. Let's respond to the reading and preaching of God's word by singing together from Psalm 37, verses 37 to 40. This is the end of Psalm 37. The tune is Abbey, which is tune number 20. Psalm 37, verses 37 to 40. The Psalms actually have a great deal to say about how God frees his people. But notice in this particular passage in verse 40, the Lord shall help and them deliver. He shall them free and save from wicked men, because in him their confidence they have. Stand for the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and grant you peace. Amen.